You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Everyone, welcome back to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Kirsten Ellsworth, and today we are going to talk about some drawing, painting, some activities that I have a feeling we've all tried ourselves. So this ought to be interesting to explore a little bit more of the familiar media. And as always, I'm looking forward to phone calls and texts from all of you. And our phone number is 800-339-1193. And you may also text in your comments, questions, observations to the askdhtv@gmail.com. And please, as always, participation makes this a lot more interesting for all of us. So with that said, why don't we start out with a question of the day? Okay, our first question of the day today. And I'll let you work on this one for a while and then start getting back to me with your answers. Okay, question of the day is going to be about Three Mile Island Night. And here's your question. How does the drawing Three Mile Island Night convey the mood of the subject? How does the drawing Three Mile Island Night convey the mood of the subject? So start working on this one, and when we come to the image, I'll be excited to hear what you have to say. Okay, today let's begin our study of the different materials of art with drawing, something that we all have done. And for artists, for well-known artists, drawing is sometimes an activity that comes before the final product. Many times artists will do sketches, they'll do preparatory studies, and they'll be drawing in order to get their ideas out, maybe to build a painting or something else. And something sort of private about drawing is the fact that a lot of times artists will keep their drawings in a notebook and possibly never intended for us to see these drawings. That's always something to take into consideration when you're looking at sort of a personal part of an artist's work, looking in a journal or a notebook, and then thinking about, well, when was this drawing completed? What was the artist thinking? And if you like this kind of study of the artist's mind and process, you definitely want to watch for exhibitions of artists' drawings, because it's a very unusual way to start looking at the work, especially of a well-known artist. So let's begin this conversation with a well-known artist, Degas, and take a look at Degas' drawing, Woman Adjusting Her Slipper. And this is from 1873. It's owned by the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And what we see here, let's look in more closely. We see some types of lines that we've discussed this term to show movement. We see sort of a shorthand use of lines to get the hairstyle of the dancer, and different kinds of lines to get the sense of the flowy dress and this pretty blue bow. So one nice element of drawing is that it can take place rather quickly, allowing the artist to capture the essence, for example, of a pose. What a very naturalistic pose here is a young dancer bending down to adjust her dance slipper. It's a very casual pose, such as Degas really liked. She's not even looking at us, right? In many ways, Degas liked to draw and then paint dancers And people who are in motion, when they're not watching you, when they're actually preparing to make their moves, or they're just lost in the dance. So in this case, another thing to consider is that after completing drawings like this, sometimes Degas would, and if I can return to the image here, he would grid these off so that, I bet you've done this, I know I've done this, he could take the smaller drawing and then piece by piece reproduce this in a much larger size, either as another drawing or perhaps as a painting. And that's called squaring for transfer. So you square off, you grid off the drawing, and then you transfer it. So we're also seeing drawing as a practical tool. On the other hand, perhaps Degas just wanted to stop with this drawing and he considered it a finished work. And today we'll definitely look at artists who present drawings as the finished work, not as a preparatory element. As we speak about drawing, we have to talk at least briefly about paper, because of course artists need something to draw on. And in history, the entity that we call paper today comes from the Latin word papyrus. And as you know, papyrus grew along, famously, right, along the banks of the Nile. And that would be in Egypt, of course. But paper as a manufactured product really comes from China. I don't think this will surprise many of us. So many things are invented in China, right? Paper comes from China, where it was invented about 105 AD or CE. But even with that date, fragments of paper existed in China before that time. So small fragments of paper. And it might interest you that paper spread from China to other regions many times alongside the religious pilgrimage, or along the trail of Buddhism, for example, where monks would have paper with depictions of different religious figures, and they would use those to teach new converts, etc., as they went something like missionary work in different areas. So there's an interesting connection between proliferation of paper and religion here. How do you make paper? Paper is made from plant fibers. It's beaten into a pulp. And then it is mixed with water and spread on a very fine screen mesh. And then, so you kind of paste it down, it'll dry, and then in history, that paper was taken off the screen and used. You can imagine that with such a labor-intensive history of the technology, paper was expensive. What are some of the other concerns with paper? It can be burned, it can get wet and get destroyed. So when you are fortunate enough to see a very old example of a drawing, for example, on paper, that survived probably because somebody found it to be important enough to preserve it. Because paper is very, very fragile. Right? Okay, let's go more into drawing. And before we do this, I am so happy someone has texted in a recent item in the news about the discovery of a very special piece of paper, or papyrus. I'm wondering if many of you are familiar with this story, and if so, you keep letting me know what you think about this. Supposedly discovered recently is a piece of papyrus or paper on which Jesus wrote, this is kind of a complex story, right? Because he wrote things, but there may only be fragments to look at. But fundamentally, on this paper, he wrote that he had a wife. And that challenges a lot of Christian doctrine. And it's not just a challenge, it contradicts some ideas of Christianity. So this fragment of paper has a fragment of writing on it. And this just happened a few weeks ago. And it says Jesus had a wife. Well, that little piece of paper, if it indeed is authentic, which it seems to be, because a professor at Harvard who's very well respected has authenticated it, that paper was saved for some interesting reasons, wasn't it? Right? So an excellent, thank you for the contribution, excellent connection of paper to current massive change, possibly, in the understanding of one part of a religion. Okay, and please continue to let me know what you think about that story or any other paper discoveries you may know about. Let's talk about the materials for drawing, and let's talk about the dry media first. Dry media, possibly the most famous here, will be the pencil. Pencil, everyone, that you use, or graphite, is an example of a dry media. That means when you use your pencil or graphite, you don't need to wet it to make color flow. It's a dry media. And Chris O'Liffey gives us a terrific example of how graphite pencil can be sort of taken to new worlds of use in Prince Among Thieves with Flowers. So let's take a look at Chris O'Liffey's drawing from 1999, Prince Among Thieves with Flowers. And some of you may remember or think, I've heard the name Chris O'Liffey. I'm not going to say what he's infamous for. I want someone to help us out here. But Chris O'Liffey made a kind of artwork in the 90s that pretty much almost got the museum shut down that wanted to show it. So if you know what that is, will you phone or text in Chris O'Liffey's controversial work? And as we're thinking about that, let's look at a less controversial piece from O'Liffey. This is a little hard to see on purpose, as you would say, right? Because he has used a very soft pencil to make an outline of a man. And I don't know how well you really have to study this. You can see there are some flowers in the background. Okay, so this is a drawing. And he uses heavier dots over here to suggest a heavier line. And then he uses less pressure on the pencil to get some of these lighter lines. It's sophisticated, and it probably took a good amount of time because I want to highlight this area for you where they're the necklace. This figure, a prince among thieves, let's take a look at the next image, which is a detail of the area I just circled. And I want you to see, look at this. All of those dots are actually tiny faces of figures with afros. So you've got two eyes, afro, man's face. If we may back up to the previous slide, now look at it in the big scale, they just look like dots. He did all of this with pencil. Now, O'Liffey is British of African descent, and I'm sure you're aware the afro has a history all its own. All hairstyles have history and politics right behind them. The afro in the late 1960s and 70s, a symbol of freedom, letting your hair grow naturally. So he seems to be interested in that kind of hairstyle, both in those little dot figures and then, of course, in the overall hairstyle of this Prince Among Thieves. And nobody is helping us out here with O'Liffey's infamous activity. I'm going to wait a few moments and then you'll never think of him the same again, I think, once you hear what he did without using a pencil. He used a different kind of material for something else. Now, Andrew is making a very interesting comment about this piece of paper that was discovered that has some words Jesus indicating he had a wife. Andrew is saying, Jesus was known for speaking in parables and metaphors, so he could have been doing like a comparison of the church being a wife to him, etc. And because we don't have a nice, full, neat text, Andrew, you have made a good observation, which is it may not be a literal comment, right? This is going to be part of the controversy. of this little fragment of paper. So thank you. The plot thickens on that story, right? Now, dry media, we just talked about pencil. The next example of a dry media is a little harder to get your mind around. So let's do this. We're going to talk about metal point, and I will talk a little bit with you about it. And then I have a short video showing a contemporary artist from Canada actually making a metal point piece or a part of a piece. So if you're feeling like, I don't know what she's talking about right now, we will see someone in our time using this technique, metal point, which is very much associated with the old masters. Today we have more discussion of the old masters, the term old master, and maybe some of you could text me in your favorite old master right now or phone in. The old masters are those artists like Rembrandt who we really respect for having sort of impeccable technique and giving us images that are iconic in history. Raphael is an old master, right? Now, the artist who made the metal point drawing you're looking at right now, Filippo Lippi, is from the 15th century, a very famous Renaissance artist. And maybe as you're looking at this, you think, oh yes, the Renaissance, because there's a standing nude and a seated man reading, and that interest in the body in the Renaissance, in particular, the ideal of a perfect male body was very strong. So, all right, if that's what the artist wants to study, and notice these are called figure studies, meaning these drawings were probably, he had a model, he was practicing, and perhaps he might choose one of these figures and place that figure in a much larger context, a different artwork. So this is a study, a preparation. And the level of naturalism is so typical of the Renaissance. We're on the topic of hairstyles today. In the Renaissance, you can always look at the hair, the treatment of the hair. There was a very strong interest in showing the contemporary hairstyles. For these men, it's a little bit long, right? And just the way in this drawing he achieved, look at the folds of the seated man's robe. And then, of course, always with Renaissance figures, look at knees, look at calves, and you see really well designed musculature, and a lot of interest if we look at the pose on showing kind of difficult poses, someone changing the weight balance over here, and then this person, what does it look like when you're seated? Okay, so we're talking about how this looks Renaissance. However, this other topic is, how did he do this? He did not draw this with just a regular pencil. And he used this technique called metal point. And I just saw a comment, I think it was from Brad, come up about why, Philip. Philip is saying there's an upside to using graphite instead of paint because of the improving and erasing tools. You're really on to something here that we're going to keep talking about today, Philip. For example, the metal point drawing that we're looking at from Lippi is harder to erase than the pencil drawing of Olippi. Boy, those names sound similar, don't they? And the degree to which the artist can erase a mistake gets more difficult. Once, you know, pencil can be erased. Almost everything else we talk about today cannot be as easily erased. So with metal point, the piece you're looking at right now, the term metal point gives it away. A metal piece of metal is used to make the drawing. And in history, that was often silver. So you have a metal point, a piece of wire, a piece of silver. But going with Philip's comment, this type of work is so unforgiving of mistakes that in many ways it has fallen away because it's very difficult. And in a contemporary time, artists just don't have the interest in this laborious technique. Very fine lines are achieved when you use a metal point, such as you see in this Lippi piece. And the trick here is that you can't just start, Lippi didn't just start this on a piece of paper. he had to have a prepared surface because metal point requires that you take your surface and you cover it with a wash and then you use your metal point. Already you see there are more steps to this. It's still considered a dry media, but it's got more. If you feel confused, how about watching Kyle Clement in this clip, this Roland. Kyle Clement will show you how in our time he uses a metal point, and I think it's going to help you appreciate this medium even more. So let's check out Kyle Clement working with metal point.
Hey, at my latest show, I have a bunch of works that are listed as being acrylic and silver point on panel. And I've had some people asking me, Kyle, what is silver point? So, in case you've never heard of this wonderful medium, let me show you. If you're anything like me, chances are you've got a sharpened piece of silver beside your bed, just in case the werewolves attack. This can also be used as a drawing medium. On regular paper, it doesn't really do a whole lot. But if you've got a piece of painted board, it's just like pencil. However, there is one significant advantage. It doesn't smudge. So when I'm being lazy and just have my hand resting on the board and I'm sketching and, you know, sliding around, I don't have a big mess of gray. I still have sharp, distinct lines. So silver point. It's fantastic. Here is the piece of silver. It's just a regular stick of pure silver. One side has been filed down to a point, and this is the point I've had for the last 8 years, so you don't really have to sharpen it all that often. And then just put it in one of these grippy pencils. There you go. You've got yourself a very nice drawing implement. This is what the old masters like Da Vinci used, because they didn't actually have graphite at the time. So all those really, really old drawings from way back when are silver on painted paper. And if you don't like the color silver gives, you can do copper. No, I don't like the copper so much. It goes on gray and turns green over time, so it's kind of cool. So that's silver point.
So does that help you get an idea of what that silver point, he calls it silver point, we're calling it metal point, how that works? And it's, as he said, it was favored by the old masters. We just saw that when we looked at this lippy piece. And then here's another question to think about. One of the reasons we're talking about drawing today is because it is a way of communicating. It's a way of preserving ideas. So how does drawings function, keep a historical record? Well, we can learn about how artists conceived the body in the Renaissance. And then Brenda has just texted in a super observation, again, about the papyrus snippet with maybe something about Jesus having a wife written on it. Brenda's saying it's, no matter what the meaning of that is, the important part is that the paper or the papyrus made sharing and record keeping of images mobile, kind of like how YouTube means you don't have to be in your living room to watch TV. It's an interesting comment. So you can have a record, you don't have to be present, right, to get the message. And this is one of the reasons why we're beginning, thank you, Brenda, it's a great comment. One of the reasons we're beginning with drawing today, because it is so prevalent, but it also really lets us understand about the past. But all history does not have to be in the 15th century, right? How about when an artist draws in order to talk about a more recent event? And in this case, the artist is the one I asked about in the question of the day. This is Yvonne Jacquet, and we're looking at Three Mile Island. Now, Jacquet, interestingly, uses a very old form or tool for drawing, which is charcoal. Charcoal is burnt wood. If you're brave and when your barbecue is cooled down, you can take a little piece of that and get a piece of paper and you can get an image. That's a very old technology. Ironically, Three Mile Island is a drawing of the breakdown of a very new technology, nuclear power. And before we look a little more closely at the image and the mood conveyed, I want to give you a chance to fire away any ideas you have about this. I also want to mention George. He is asking, is the way we make paper today significantly different than the original way it was made? Well, now we can make paper in factories and we don't have to, it's a great question, we don't have to lay down a piece, a paste, you know, on every screen. Paper can be mass produced, and as you know, trees can be, most parts of them can be used in the paper making process. So it's faster, and we can get colored paper, and you can still make paper by hand though, and you can still buy handmade paper if you want to see that thickness. But as you know, the paper we have now does not show pulp or anything like that. Okay, now returning to Jacquette's image of Three Mile Island. Old technology, burnt charcoal, okay, new technology, nuclear power, and an incident of our history that happened in 1982. And Three Mile Island in Pennsylvania was the site of a nuclear accident in 1979, pardon me. It happened in 1979, and she rendered this in 1982. And I'm hoping you're looking and seeing how that dry material conveys a pretty apocalyptic, and this is very frightening, especially with what happened in Japan recently, it's even more frightening. What happens when there is a threat of a meltdown? Now we have a caller calling in to help us out here. So, caller, we have John calling from Northridge. John, what did you want to say with us? Speak to
Hi,
us about
this
today.
Was actually a comment back on old masters and the Renaissance drawings.
Yes.
And I wanted to know if you considered that Michelangelo was an old master, had you heard that he spent time not in a cemetery, but like in a mortuary where he could actually see dead bodies to study the actual musculature and get it correctly?
Yes. There is evidence that Michelangelo and others were able to look at cadavers and...
Yeah, that's a better word, yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, the same thing you're saying, right? Cadavers to look at basically what it looks like under our skin. And that has been put forth with some good support as a reason why you can see better musculature and what we would say is more realistic looking treatment of the body during the Renaissance. And...
Right.
Just, I want to ask you a question. If they were able to go into an environment and be around a body like that, how would they have taken their notes?
How would they have taken their notes?
When they were looking, how would they record their impressions to use later?
Not sure what you mean. If they can see, I don't know what material they had at the time, but I think they would... They would, A, make a mental note. They're visual artists.
Mm-hmm.
They would make a mental note. And I think they would do some sketches, and I think they would just do a lot of research.
Yes, mental note, and you mentioned sketches. Since we're speaking about drawing, I think, yes, that's what I was thinking of in combination
They would just spend a lot of time, they could always take it apart if they wanted to.
Yes, and I'm not sure if they were actually allowed, you know.
No, but I just thought that they would draw it over or just look over and over and over again, go as many times as they could.
I think you're right. And, John, thank you for calling. If anyone wants to put themselves in the position of looking at a cadaver and sketching and trying to imagine that, and, you know, you would be looking and looking and looking because the curiosity factor is so high, and then you need your drawing to record your impressions so you can go back later. And that's another interesting part of the story of some of the old masters. So thank you, John, for reminding us of that. Okay, If we look at Three Mile Island again, we're still looking at drawing, but let's go with what John was saying. We can't really imagine that Yvonne Jacquet was standing at the reactors when this scare occurred. So perhaps her sources were newspaper articles, news reports, and, you know, anything like that would have focused in on discussion of the different reactors. And perhaps this stuck in her mind as her sort of visual research. And she even uses this black and white that is so effectively understood through charcoal, and also has that newspaper, when newspapers used to do be popular, right? In that black and white feel, also giving us a stark, probably, quality here, because we're talking about radioactivity and the possible destruction that could be the result of something, a full meltdown, right? So using charcoal to convey this, to convey a piece of history that she probably didn't witness firsthand, but she digested through popular culture and then decided to render this image. So this is that use of charcoal. I'm hoping that as we're going here, you're seeing that the artist has a lot of choices for medium, even in just what might seem, oh, just drawing. And then that medium needs to sort of go along with the subject in some way that may not be understood by us or maybe private for the artist. Let's go a little more optimistic. What about artists who see the lighter side of life and more ethereal qualities of life, and even just the beauty in a small subject? And here we can certainly talk about Jean-Antoine Watteau. And let's look at the seated young woman. Here's the subject for him, is a younger looking woman sitting down and very delicate, very feminine. And he has used chalk, also known as pastel, as his chosen dry media to render this. Now chalk, really, it can be shaded. If you've ever used pastels, you can use your fingers to get nice colors. It tends to work in the world of pastel, what we call pastel colors, pinks, blues, and therefore present a lighter view of life sometimes. Let's take a closer look at this piece. And even though he does not use a lot of color, look at just her face seems very soft, and her hair is a little bit loose and soft, round shoulders. You can imagine a nice soft pastel in his hand to sort of let this flow. If you like to look at pastels, you must go to the Getty Center in Brentwood, because they have a special room of pastel drawings. And if any of you have been there, you know that it's darkened, because you can't have a lot of light showing on the pastels over time, because they will deteriorate. Something else to think of, a pastel is like a chalk. So once the artist finishes the drawing, such as the case here, some kind of fixative is applied to hold the fine powders down, because these kinds of drawings will become smudged. And Watteau is, this piece is from 1717. This is a time, especially in France a little bit later, you're going to have the Rococo period, where there was an interest in sort of aristocratic subjects and lighthearted subjects. And then we see pastel and, of course, pastel colors used. I think we're getting somewhere here on the dry media, and I'm enjoying your comments very much. I think there's a familiarity we can, you know, have with these works. If we go into liquid media, what's going to happen? The liquid media for drawing require a liquid, and there is, think about your own tastes, there's a type of smoothness to these works, an uninterrupted flow, because the artist has the tool and the liquid. It's very difficult to correct errors, returning to Philip's point, And in history, pen and ink, for example, you had a nib for the pen, usually made of a quill, and a natural, like a bird's quill or a reed. Nowadays, George was asking about how different is paper making now. Well, nowadays pens have metal nibs or points on them, right? And they're mass produced, and you can get all these thicknesses, etc. But in older times, you didn't have that range. Let's talk about Rembrandt. If you've been waiting for old masters, and in particular Rembrandt, here we are. Because Rembrandt was very, very famous in general, and he was extremely well known for these kinds of pen and ink drawings. And you're looking at Cottage Among Trees from 1648. And Rembrandt was appreciated by many people. I think you should look at this, and if you want to tell us if you think it's worthy of the merit always given to a piece by Rembrandt or not, you can certainly disagree. Is it as important as we say, Rembrandt's works? But he was really valued for his incredible drawing technique and all the different kinds of lines. And you have to imagine he's doing this pen and ink. So he's got a lot of control if you look at the different trees and the shading. And Rembrandt, the value of Rembrandt, which I think we could discuss, you know, whether we think it's merited or not today. If we want to talk dollars, everybody, some of the highest auction prices in our times have gone to works by Rembrandt. And I want to show you a clip of an auction from 2009. And the art auction is for the old masters. I'm still waiting to hear. I've already heard Michelangelo as a favorite from John, or possibly a favorite. I want to hear more favorites of the old masters. And in this clip, I want you to notice the first example that is up for auction is a drawing by Raphael. Okay. And then watch and see how the prices go for some of these drawings by old masters. So let's look at the clip, an art auction for the old masters.
At £26 million.
If the global recession is hampering people's buying power, the big spenders of the art world haven't heard about it yet. The sale of old masters at Christie's in London has just smashed a string of records. Raphael's Head of Muse went for a mammoth $42 million before commission. The early 16th century work fetched the highest price ever paid for any work on paper. It's also a world record for a Raphael and the second highest in the world for an old master. Christie's joint international head, Richard Knight, says it's exceeded all their expectations.
Despite the present economic climate, we work in a very robust market. Old master paintings and drawings have been extraordinarily resilient over the past year, culminating now this Christmas in these quite spectacular results. And of course it bodes well for next year.
The same sale also saw this Rembrandt make history. The hammer fell at over $29 million, a new world record for the artist at auction. And it didn't stop there.
For £8,200,000.
Il Domenichino's John the Evangelist went for more than $13 million.
It was, of course, a world record price for the artist because no other painting by Domenichino of that importance has ever appeared on the market.
In total, the entire collection of old masters and 19th century art brought in more than $114 million when commissions added. The auctioneers are hoping the trend will continue, but even they admit Tuesday night's performance will be a tough one to top. Chapman, Reuters.
Yes, I bet they hope that trend continues. $140 million for that particular auction. I told you drawing was important. You know, save all those drawings. The first drawing that we saw in that video, the Raphael, very lovely, in my opinion. Nice, smooth flow, etc. But the price, very interesting. There's also something to think about with drawing. And that is that connoisseurs and collectors really like to have that sense of the artist's hand, this is an older idea, on the page or on the painting, and to know, well, that was Raphael's hand that rendered that. And that also makes the price go up. I just hope somebody wants to comment here about prices. I'm sure you're feeling some opinions about those high prices, so let me know what you think about the prices for these old master drawings recently auctioned, right? Even during the recession. Let's go back in time and go into one of the earliest liquid media. You've got pen and ink, which we just spoke about with Rembrandt, but you also can have brush and ink. And brushes are old. We spoke about this earlier, this term, brushes for the cave paintings, and the brushes might have been made out of animal hair, just tied together to make a brush. Well, coming from China and then introduced to Japan is a terrific tradition of brush and ink painting. And what happens here is that we have ink, water, and a brush. And when you watch the video I'm going to show you, if you look carefully, I believe to the left side of the artist, it's a Japanese artist, you'll see that he has a small black slate. And on this slate, he has put water, and then he rubs ink in a form of a stick, so like a hardened ink, in that water and gets a nice black color. Then he takes the brush and dips it, and then you're going to see what he does. And remember that you can get a lot of variety when you're using brush and ink, because that wash, which is when wash means the water and the ink together, right? When you dip into that, how much pressure you put on the brush, which choice of brush, all of this comes into play as you use this liquid media. So let's go ahead and watch. Now this one is Hirokazu Kosoka, a very well-known Japanese artist who was photographed at the Indianapolis Museum of Art doing his brush and ink work. So this one, I say, relax and enjoy, because you can get lost in the seeming simplicity of his work, but it's so powerful. So let's go ahead and watch this clip from the Indianapolis Museum of Art.
To do calligraphy or even to learn the Chinese or Japanese characters, first thing I think I remember, the first word was tree. And tree is written like this. And I was told that if you write two trees right next to each other, it means a small forest. And if you put three trees together like that, it means deep forest. But if you write this character, it means a rain or mist right next to two trees like that. Doesn't mean the rainforest, but it means lonely. If a man goes into a small forest by himself and there is a mist right in front of it, the forest, the man feels very lonely. And this is the character for loneliness. This particular character came from a pictograph symbol of a bird wing, like that. And this character means heart or your mind or your spirit. So if you put a wing of a bird and with your heart being caressed by these wings, it means sad. This character means sad. This character came from a symbol of a yarn or five color strand. It means yarn. And if you put this yarn or string with a character meaning to meet, it means painting. So five color strand with meeting, it means painting.
I don't know, everyone, I'm lost in delight when I watch the video there. And I have to say, my favorite media today is this liquid media of brush and ink. I want to try it. When I watch that, I want to leave after our broadcast today and go try this and see how to get those different thicknesses of line. And the way he communicates, you know, the symbols and the beauty of just a few lines and with a complex meaning, sadness, for example, is incredible to me. Now, that's my personal preference. You certainly don't need to share that at all, but I like that simplicity of the media that actually speaks to something really deep. Now, I've got some terrific comments that came through while we were watching the video about, and this is a nice review of some of the things we've spoken about, Rembrandt, and you know, he seems to be a great artist, why not? And I'm hearing from Andrew that it, and this is a terrific comment, the drawing seems simple. Remember, this was the cottage in the trees? Thank you. The drawing seems simple, but a closer look reveals he needed great control. Yes, to make such detailed lines, to produce figures of trees and detailed shading. Control is the word. Control with a liquid media, which isn't always as easy to control nor to erase. So here's a nice comment in support of this label great that we give Rembrandt. And then I hear from Philip about the prices of old masterworks such as this. And he says, it's extreme. The prices are extreme. Question from Philip, if I made a work of art and it lasted longer than my death, would the price go up? Possibly, if you were in the right place at the right time when you were alive, Philip. I mean, that's one of those questions that comes round and round and round. It's a good question about value. And why certain artists. And then we can return to our charcoal drawing, which was also the drawing that was at the heart of the question of the day, Jacquet's 3 Mile Island. And Ibrahim is saying he sees a critique here. And Ibrahim, thank you for getting into this level of the work. I believe 3 Mile Island is a critique of nuclear energy, especially the contrast between the new nuclear energy and old-time charcoal. The juxtaposition of the medium and the artist's subject is foreboding. The juxtaposition of the medium, the charcoal, and the subject, the failure of a dangerous technology, is foreboding. And he has an exclamation point there. Yes. And when we look at this, having seen what happened in Japan, that becomes even more palpable. And here's a case where the image stirs a lot in us, right? It stirs a lot. And Joshua also wants to say something about 3 Mile Island and the mood. His adjectives are very real. Sadness, darkness, panic, and fear. sadness, darkness, panic, and fear. And that charcoal in the hand of that artist is getting this feeling out for us. And I have Jocelyn wanting to help us out with old masters that she likes. And I know Jocelyn is the person in our class who got to see Guernica in person. So Picasso is a master, right? I don't know, is he an old master? Is he a master? I don't know. But Jocelyn is saying she really likes Diego Velázquez because I've seen his work at the Prado and not just prints. And you are very fortunate for that. And also Jocelyn likes El Greco. So I'm hearing about some Spanish masters, which is nice because sometimes once we name Rembrandt, Rafael, Rembrandt, we're getting some new names here for us, Velázquez and El Greco. And as you're, thank you for commenting on your favorites, you know, thinking about why you like them. I'm hoping that time spent in our broadcast will help you appreciate them even more, even for just what materials they were using, right? And again, my favorite is always going to be creating through brush and ink, and you can weigh in for me what your favorites are as we go through the broadcast, because we're going to be moving. We have one more drawing I'd like to speak with you about. We'll take a break, and then there'll be other media we're going to talk about, and as you see something that's your favorite, let me know. Let's briefly look at Raymond Pettibone's drawing. It's an installation drawing at Reagan Projects. Just to conclude our conversation about drawing with a new trend, a new direction, which is, and it may be hard to capture this, if maybe we could zoom in on this one, something that's happening more lately is that artists actually draw right on the wall of a gallery or museum, and sometimes it's a series of small drawings or things are tacked up. I see a zebra here, and I don't know how that connects to the train over here. Probably Raymond Pettibone has an idea since he did this. And these drawings challenge your idea that there's a certain subject, a certain background, a certain tree, and they're sort of all over the place, almost like a specific language understood to the artist and then presented for you. If you get to see one of these in person, you really have to walk and look at little parts of the drawing. It's a very interesting experience, very different from just the single drawing. And this technique of sort of putting things and you put them together, you put the drawings together. Matthew Haddad has made a comment that absolutely connects here. And Matthew is talking about calligraphy in his comment. But what he says could apply to Raymond Pettibone's work if you accept his little faces and critters and animals as sort of shorthand writing for him. Matthew says he finds it fascinating when characters are combined properly. They create a picture that describes a new word. So if I can draw a little bit more out of Matthew's comment here, you know, an artist can draw, whether it's calligraphy, text, or small pictures of meaning to him or her, that when that's all put together, a new word comes out, a new idea, if I can add to what you're saying, Matthew, comes out. And then an interactive work such as Pettibone's gets pretty interesting as you try to access his world of communication through drawing. Terrific comments, everyone. Why don't we take our 5-minute break and return and talk about painting and add to our discussion of different media. So let's go ahead and have a 5-minute break and come back and discuss painting.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Being new to this campus and my role as president, I have the same eagerness as an incoming freshman and the same nervousness that one has when you're taking on a new experience, especially one as big as this. And even though you've anticipated, you still have that sense of, you know, you hope you can do it well. People come to Dominguez Hills to get transformed. The dedication and the commitment of the Dominguez Hills faculty and the staff under daunting financial and operational circumstances is incredible. And how much more is this campus capable of? What can be done, what can be achieved for our students is boundless if we are all working together, sharing, communicating, focused. This campus has been tested under pressure, but the character that has been revealed is one of self-sacrifice, putting mission and students first. Good work has been done here in the past. Now, this is our turn. As we look forward to the future of this institution, let's build something awesome. Let's build something divine. As I said earlier, I don't have to do this job, I get to do this job. Being president of this university is an honor and a privilege, and I thank the people who made it possible, and I thank all of you who have been so gracious in welcoming me here. Thank you very much.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory base and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org, so opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on them. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
Hi, my name is Mark Darcy. I'm a student at CSUDH, and I'm in the Orthotics and Prosthetics program. I love this program, I enjoy it, and this is my dream.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Well, welcome back to Art 100 Looking at Art. I'm Kirsten Ellsworth, and we are going to forge ahead on our discussion of media, and I'm going to answer a question that I asked, that's odd, isn't it, about Chris O'Liffey, who did that pencil drawing that we started with, The Prince Among Thieves. In addition to using pencil, O'Liffey also used elephant dung in some of his works. And he rendered a depiction of a Madonna figure using elephant dung as the material. And this caused quite a controversy. Rudy Giuliani was involved in this. And yet O'Liffey argued that, and here is the work by O'Liffey we spoke of earlier, O'Liffey argued that the use of elephant dung was absolutely in honor of his subject, which in this case was the Madonna, the Christian Virgin Mary, because dung is nature, and he didn't see that as offensive in any way, but some people did. So just another little comment here on the politics of the different media. Now we're going to talk about painting. And I've got questions on the table for you, and we're getting super answers. Your favorite old masters. I would up the ante on that one. Can you, someone give me a woman artist? Because it does seem that the old masters category is largely considered male, but I think there's some women that could be in that category. That's the first question. The second question, as we're proceeding here, what's your favorite media today? I already told you that mine was brush and ink. And then here's another question of the day. We're going to talk about tempera paintings. What was one subject common in tempera painting? What was one subject common in tempera painting? So you've got some things to think about and talk to us about. And let's start with into the discussion of painting. And let's begin with the oldest type of painting we know. And this is so old that who knows when it really began. This is called encaustic. Encaustic. And encaustic painting, as old as it is, everyone, and we will look at an old example in a moment. As old as encaustic painting is, a rather famous artist from the 60s revived it. And it's still used, it's in a bit of a revival today, and that was Jasper Johns. If you want to take a look at the famous flag by Jasper Johns at some point before the end of our course, you will see the use of encaustic. Bet you didn't know that one. A lot of people don't. What is encaustic? The main ingredient here is wax. It's a wax type of painting with wax. And if we go back in history, so we depart from Jasper Johns' use of encaustic, and we go back in time. Look at this portrait of a young woman with a gold pectoral, Roman, and look at the date, 100 to 150 BCE. This is a portrait that is made when the artist mixed the pigments for the colors desired with wax. Wax, think about it. If you melt wax, you get that terrific smell. And then you put your color, like look at all the gold pigment used here. Just unbelievable, right? And the whatever the artist used to get those pearls, those luminescent pearls, those pigments were mixed with wax, a melted wax. The artist took a brush, dipped it into this waxy substance, and then placed on this board whatever was desired for the portrait. Look at the incredible skin tones. There's a jewel here on her scarf or shawl. And look at the eyes. These specific, this group of encaustic portraits, there are some beautiful examples at the Getty Villa. I really encourage you to see. And if you look at several of them in a row or in one place, you will notice that each really seems to want to capture something about the person. And it's often in the eyes, very, very expressive eyes. And where were these portraits found? Well, these are actually mummy portraits. at this time, people were still mummified as they were in ancient Egypt, but now you've got the Romans and the Egyptians sharing procedure, you know, art and culture and takeovers and all of this, right? But what we have here, on top of the mummy bundle, which would look like a mummy, you know, wrapped up, they would place a portrait, one of these, right on top of that to show the face of the person whose body is in the mummy. And the portraits, such as the one you're looking at, they usually show people of status. Look at the jewelry, hairstyles, clothing, fineries. And then the wax, one of the wonderful things about encaustic is it's very durable and it lasts. And the colors will stay vivid because they're preserved in wax. So this kind of portrait looks as fresh as it, you know, as when it was made because of the encaustic painting technique. So encaustic is really, the examples that we have are so well preserved that we can learn a lot through about the history through these, through the use of the encaustic as the material. Encaustic is old, old, old. Fresco is also famous, a famous type of painting, and it's also old by our standards, but we can speak of the Renaissance again for a true rise in fresco technique. And fresco, it's painting. And what we have here is a pigment to get a color, is mixed with water, and then applied to damp plaster. Often on a wall, most or many frescoes were done right in the architecture. So, for example, the School of Athens behind me here, this was a fresco Raphael painted in the Pope's study in the Vatican Palace. So this was quite a task. Raphael was shown his space on the wall, and everyone, this is all a trick of illusion. Everything in this fresco you're looking at that looks like a sculpture or an architecture, this is all two-dimensional, illusionistic. This is not anything but flat. And that's where we get into the incredible techniques of the Renaissance with perspective. We've got a one kind of vanishing point. We get another one up here. All to give you the sense of three-dimensionality. So fresco. Very hard to correct a mistake. You're painting on a wet plaster. When the plaster dries, if you've made a mistake, you have to remove the plaster and replace the plaster and start over again. Now, I want to show you a clip from Columbia University that I think gives a great insight into how this fresco was made. And before we start it, I want to give you two tips. First of all, the subject matter of the School of Athens is are two schools of philosophy, one associated with Plato, one with Aristotle. So I think this will help you when you're watching the clip. That's what Raphael wanted to work on, the two schools of philosophy. The clip will begin with the drawings he made. Here we are with preparatory drawings. So he made drawings for this initially, and then the cartoon. Here's the real meaning of the word cartoon, everyone. The cartoon that you will see, the cartoon is the large, large drawing on a big piece of paper, cartoon in the Renaissance, that he pinned up to the wall, and then he had a little technique for transferring his drawing, removed the cartoon or paper, and then he could start the fresco. So watch for the cartoon, the large piece of paper. And let's go ahead and watch this clip from Columbia University on the School of Athens by Raphael.
Painted a fresco, that is, directly on the freshly plastered wall. In this technique, the water-based paint is applied to a surface of wet plaster. Absorbed by the plaster, the colors bond with the lime and become an integral part of the dried wall. Painting a fresco requires a certain rapidity of execution, for once the plaster dries, it will no longer absorb the pigments properly. Applied to the dry wall, a secco, they will not enjoy the permanence of true fresco technique. Raphael developed his composition through a series of drawings, from rough sketches to careful studies of individual figures. Nearly every detail was worked out first in drawing. The culmination of this process of thorough graphic preparation was the cartoon, a word deriving from the Italian cartone, meaning a large piece of paper, carta. Assembled from many separate pieces of paper, the cartoon fixed the composition in a monumental drawing. This was then transferred to the wall by a process known as pouncing. The outlines of the drawing were pricked with a nail, and a gauze bag of charcoal powder was then dusted over the surface, leaving a design of black dots on the wall, which would then be gone over with brush and paint. In this way, the linear composition was traced upon the wall. The design was first transferred to a rough surface, known in Italian as the arriccio. This layer was then covered by a finer, smooth coat of plaster, known as the intonaco, on which the colors were to be applied. The process entailed yet another transfer of the design, a reapplication of the cartoon, either by pouncing or by incision into the wet plaster. This was done in pieces small enough to be painted in a single day, a giornata in Italian, that is, before the plaster dried. The School of Athens reveals 59 giornate, telling us just how many days were required to paint the mural. In order to add the Michelangelesque figure of Heraclitus, then, Raphael had to remove an area of the painted intonaco and then replaster it, applying a new cartoon. The additional painting was executed in 2 giornate. The philosophers in Raphael's School of Athens gather in a public space inspired by the great monuments of ancient imperial Rome, the vaulted baths of Caracalla and of Diocletian. This painted architecture is distinctly of the High Renaissance. Raphael's structure rises on a centralized plan. From its circular core extend 4 arms to create a Greek cross. Apparently open to the heavens, that central core invites a covering dome. Raphael's architecture reflects the project of his friend Bramante for the new St. Peter's, which was to replace the crumbling early Christian basilica that had...
It would be fun to watch the rest of that. However, I just want to keep us focused on the fresco painting, and I hope you saw this process of drawing, pouncing, or pricking out the lines. Take the cartoon, put it on the wall, cartoon has the drawing, pounce around the lines, put a chalk over that, pull off your paper, you have your guidelines, and then the fresco painting begins in a day, because if the colors dry so quickly and they have to be consistent. It's a very intricate technique, and I'm thinking someone out there probably will favor this favorite media for today, the fresco. But something happens in the history of art. Artists want something a little faster than fresco, or a little, maybe faster isn't the proper word, a little more intimate, and not for wall painting, not the use of plaster. And this brings us to tempera, your question of the day, or your second question of the day, tempera. And I asked you what subjects were commonly used in tempera painting. Well, tempera painting brings you some of the most luxurious looking religious subjects from the Middle Ages, as well as portraits. And tempera, let's look at our example, St. Anthony. Thank you. Let's look closely here. Tempera uses an egg yolk as the binder. So you have a pigment and a liquid, and the liquid is usually an egg yolk or a fat or something like that. And it dries very quickly. The colors are not easily blended, and they get brilliant qualities. So it's perfect for rendering halos, for example. And it's also it makes subjects rather flat, because you can't shade very much with tempera. And what we're looking at here is Saint Anthony, who, as the story goes, was tempted by a bag of gold. And then if you pursue this story, you learn about, you know, how he overcomes his temptations. And tempera is very good for miniature work as well, because you don't really blend it. You put the color down and that's the color you get. And that egg substance is your binder. There are artists who work in tempera today, but something else happened in history. And once we get the next material for painting, tempera begins to look sort of antiquated and clunky, let's say. Although many medieval works, if you like art from the Middle Ages, which we'll speak about later this term, tempera gave it that beautiful quality of shining quality. But during the Renaissance, just as we have fresco painting, we also have oil painting. And once we get to oil paint, it becomes so much preferred over tempera. And for some artists, it's so intimate, because oil paint, the binder is oil, pigment plus oil. Oil paint blends easily. It dries very slowly. And the origins of oil paint in the early 15th century really are attached to one artist in particular, Jan van Eyck. Let's look at his Man in a Red Turban. This is a very important oil painting for many reasons. Van Eyck did not invent oil paint. Please beware. He did not invent it, but he exploited it a lot. And works such as this, oil paint allows for glazes or thin layers of paint that are applied over thicker layers. And then an artist can build. Look at the skin. Look at the lines on the face. I feel like if I touch this turban, it's probably velvet. Oil paint gives you a much, much more depth than does tempera. Tempera dries fast, you get your color. You can blend with the oils. And oil painting also brings in the idea of a smaller canvas. You could roll up, canvases were made, they were rolled up. And artists could be more portable and take their canvases around and work on their oil paintings. We don't know, by the way, if this is a self-portrait for Van Eyck. It might be. It's really intriguing to people because this figure seems to be looking right at us, kind of boldly, or is he bored? I don't know what qualities you would ascribe to him. And again, Van Eyck really made people think about the use of oil. And of course, oil painting, many of the old masters' works are in oil. But oil painting is used today as well. And let's look briefly at John Sonsini's oil painting, Fernando, Manuel, and David. This is from 2006. And so if we look closely here, here's a contemporary artist using oil, an old medium. And he does two things that are really interesting. Alla prima is a term that you might apply to this. This means that the artist executes all in one go, all at one time. He uses the oil, but he doesn't layer it and use the older techniques. He just lets it fly, and alla prima means that this was done quickly. He also has a lot of impasto here. Impasto, if you look at the genes, for example, there's a thickness, a texture. He doesn't push the oil paint down or smooth it out. He lets it be thick, almost like icing on a cake. And this is a group of day laborers. So this is also not a subject that someone like Van Eyck would have approached, because in the earlier times, oil painting was, you know, for these so-called elite subjects, usually some landscapes. So interestingly, Sonsini's taken the old medium, but he's showing you something about contemporary life, right? So this is where artists can go back in time and reapply their favorite media. I want to, as we come to the end of our time together, I want to talk about watercolor, because I know I've tried watercolor. I will never show you what those results are, but watercolor is a type of painting where the vehicle is water, pigment and water, and it's very transparent. You can still apply it in layers, and landscape seems to be a favorite subject for watercolor. This is John Singer Sargent, a very well-known artist. He's really known for portraits, but he has a body of work that are watercolor nature scenes. And if you look at Mountain Stream, there is a human being in this scene. He's nude over here. Scenes of water flowing, rivers, seem very apt for the use of watercolor, because watercolor is fast and moves, and it can be light, spontaneous. Watercolor is a type of painting that sometimes artists do as preparatory work, because they can take their art, their watercolors, and do a quick watercolor work and then maybe use that for something later. Now, in contrast, just as a reminder, I just saw a comment from Andrew about Diego Rivera's tempera work. And it is true that tempera, I think that comment was saying tempera is so permanent, it can't be erased, it's durable. What a contrast with watercolor. Watercolor is fast, it's not always precise, we don't expect that. Whereas tempera, we expect it's a little bit rigid as a medium. So watercolor. Now let's conclude with the 20th century invention. Basically, it's plastic, everyone. Acrylic paint. And Omar is saying he likes acrylic paint the best, because you can copy the effects of watercolor and oil paint, and acrylic looks cool when it's blended. Acrylic paint for life. Omar, you're a real good spokesperson for acrylic. I have a feeling, and I'm wondering if you're a painter, because yes, once acrylic or polymer paint was developed in the 20th century, things really changed, because what you have here is a vehicle of acrylic resin. So when you're using acrylic paints, they can be worked almost any way you want them. You can have a glaze. You can have a thick paint stroke, an impasto. It dries quickly. It cleans up using water. Remember to clean oil paint. If you've ever painted with it, you have to use turpentine. The colors don't dilute, so you can, let's look at, if we're looking right here at Stefan Mueller's Riparian Revival. This is acrylic. If you look carefully here, he uses acrylics. He can lay down a blue square, like an aqua blue square, on these lighter blue colors, and it doesn't get blurry or blend too much. Acrylics let you play with really bright color schemes. You can lay down a form like this on another color, and you don't have to worry about the blending properties or that suddenly the colors will dilute. Acrylic can do just about everything, right? And just looking at more comments, we definitely have Omar weighing in. Yes, acrylic for life. I do see Wesley saying he likes the charcoal medium because it gives mood and contrast. If I can summarize your comments a little bit, Wesley. interesting because that's a very different sensibility than our acrylic painting. Now, I also hear Raphael, favorite old master. We'll be talking about Raphael again. I'm still waiting for a woman old master, and you can weigh in on that one in another broadcast. We'll have that as a homework assignment. Talk to me about some well-known women artists of older times. So today we have talked about drawing. We've talked about painting, dry media, liquid media, acrylic, the paint of our time, plastic. It moves fast. It doesn't blend. It's easy use. Oil from the Renaissance, fresco from the Renaissance, brush and ink, my favorite, pure pencil drawing. All of these techniques are used, as I hope you're seeing today, they're used to communicate whatever the artist wants to communicate or explore personally. And the choice is in the artist's hands. And just as food for thought, a final thought for the class, there have been times in history where artists sort of do something with these materials that surprises everyone and invents a new category. And the new category of today is collage. And since I know everyone here has tried collage, let's end with some Romare Bearden's Mysteries from 1964. Artists confronted with all the choices of paint, from painting to drawing, you look at Bearden's Mysteries from 1964, and suddenly you see an artist using clips from magazines, pasting magazine papers down to make a collage. And or we could look at Picasso, which we have right here, Guitar and Wine Glass. Is it drawing? Is it painting? What is it? Well, collage comes into our story here as the anything goes kind of approach to two-dimensional work. And what we see here is the artist painting or gluing down paper, cloth, all different kinds of things to make a work of art that might look like a drawing to you, but it turns out to be made of pasted papers and words. If you look carefully here, you see Picasso using words and simulating textures and things like this. So just when you feel confident, we've got the drawing and the painting down, nope. The world is so much bigger. Artists want to do more, and yet they will always return to drawing, a fundamental, or the watercolor sketch, a fundamental. So it's a really wonderful world of materials for artists, and I doubt you would find an artist who would say, I only use this media. That would really surprise me. Even in the older times, you see such a variety. And hold that thought, because we're going to come back next week and we're going to talk about even more ways to make a work of art. Thank you very much for today. I look forward to seeing you next week. Same place, same time.